companies I do clinical trials with, so just them in my disclosures. But today, basically, I'm just talking six parts. The impact of the cost of care on the patient, what the oncologist, what the physician can do about it. You understand why the cost of these cancer drugs are rising so quickly, and what's keeping those prices up there. And then kind of how we define value and how we can improve all of this, and maybe even drive down prices, make it more affordable. So we'll start with the patient. There's a lot of stark realities about the cost of this care. And in the US, cancer care alone will be about $158 billion. And we think about indirect costs over $300 billion. And we'll talk about what indirect costs are. As far as drug classes, this is number one in terms of spending, over $100 billion a year globally. And the cost of drug for each year used is quadrupled in the last few years after adjusting for inflation. And the trend is just more and more upward. And so an example here is about $8,500 a year is what a drug, and we're talking about the same drug, not new drug, just going up in cost every year. One drug that we use for lymphoma over the last 4 years has gone up 30,000 to about 30% of its initial cost, which is example. So medical reasons were cited as the number one source of bankruptcy. Over 62% in 2007, and that's increasing as well. And it's not just low income people. Most people are in the middle class and they have insurance, and this is still happening. This is because of their co-payments and co-insurance obligations. Cancer patients have over a 2.5-fold risk of filing for bankruptcy. And then those who declare bankruptcy is find out they're more likely to die. And they report poor physical and mental health. A lot of people use up all their money paying for their cancer costs and using up all their savings and having trouble paying bills. And some of them actually delay their care or never come in at all to seek care for their cancer because they're afraid of paying for it. And then, so that's just a direct cost, the bills you get from your doctor and, your medicines. But there's also a lot of indirect costs to these patients. They come in to get treatment, see the doctor, so they're not working that day. And that's kind of why we try to do Saturday infusions down in Salt Lake. Family members often have to take off from work and take care of the cancer patients, so you're losing money there. Just getting back and forth, people can come a long way for treatment sometimes. And, down in Salt Lake where they come from all the neighboring states, and they have to stay for a while, they get care. They have to find housing near the hospital for that time. They have children, child care expenses. And then, unfortunately, a lot of times after the treatment's over, they don't have their jobs not waiting for them anymore, and they lose their insurance. And then even the patient that we're luckily able to cure, when they go back to work, studies show that they don't make as much as, a counterpart that didn't have cancer. So quality of life is also really an important part here, and we're talking about insured patients here. But they're cutting back on leisure activities, spending less on food, not saving as much, selling things to pay for their costs, and working more. So they already have this tough situation where they're dealing with cancer, and now they're doing all this other stuff too, so their quality of life is really substantially impacted. And then there's medical issues as well. So we've looked at this, and again, still insured patients, but they're taking less of their prescription they're supposed to try to stretch it longer, or partially filling them, or not filling them at all. And they're avoiding appointments, tests, procedures as well, because they're worried about the cost that they incur with all of this. And then it translates to how they're feeling, too. So one study, basically, they asked cancer patients, if you stopped making all the income in your current job, only had savings left, how long could you live off of your savings? The current standard of living. And they asked this to colon cancer patients. And those that only had 2 months or less where they could survive off compared to over a year, they reported on these surveys a much lower quality of life and more symptoms. And so there's really a connection between the financial strain they're experiencing and their symptoms they're feeling in terms of their health. And then looking at it a year later, those with more financial strain, they have worse health, greater activity impairment, more pain and depression. I think part of this is because they can't access the support, medication, supportive care, therapies that they need to recover from the cancer diagnosis and treatment. Then young patients are especially vulnerable. So if you're younger, you still often have dependent children, you haven't paid off the mortgage, you know, you're still making lower income because you haven't gotten those promotions, you haven't been able to save money yet. And so financial issues even more accentuated. And then again, patients that have been treated curatively, they still report financial distress for many years after their cancer care is finished. And they still have a lot of debt from it. And again, sometimes their jobs aren't waiting for them when they're done, so they don't have work. And then there are patients that will just completely refuse treatment, which is sad. They don't want their families to be left with their medical debt once they pass away. So they'd rather just walk away from it all. And they'll even refuse pain relief, palliative care, things that make them feel better, just because they won't want to incur these costs and burden their families. And I think that's really sad, and we should find ways to try to work on this within our healthcare system. So we've been mostly talking about insured patients, but the uninsured obviously are vulnerable. Insurance is getting more and more expensive. Small employers are dropping coverage. We know that these patients don't come to get screened for their cancer, which means we find it later, and it's more advanced and harder to treat at that point, and ultimately they die sooner. But there's another concept, which is the underinsured. So these are people with insurance, but they can't afford their out-of-pocket obligations. So these are co-pays, co-insurance, deductibles, and then you guys probably heard about the donut hole for Medicare patients. I'll talk about that a little more, what that is. You know, initially, the idea behind making patients pay a little bit was good, right? They wouldn't want people to come in for every little thing when it wasn't necessary. So the thought was, if they have to pay a little bit, they'll think about more if they want to come in. And so that might be good for certain things, but for cancer, you know, I don't think it's a good thing to clear these patients to need our care. And so out-of-pocket costs have really skyrocketed, and I'll show you some graphs to show you that for cancer patients. And ultimately, there's going to be disparities between different socioeconomic groups, those that have and those that don't have, have not, because obviously people with more financial means will be able to afford their care and have more access to care. So the donut hole, basically, what happens is initially, and we're talking about oral medications that Medicare patients are, they have a standard copay, and then once they get to a certain level of a few thousand, that copay actually goes up quite a bit. They have to pay even more for their medication. And then there's a top ceiling, like catastrophic limit, where it goes back down again, but not to zero. So that's in between area is where they really have to pay a big portion of their medication. That's the donut hole. And so often they have to get another insurance to help with their bad. I have a lot of veterans I take care of at the VA in Salt Lake, and they'll come to me for their medications because that's one way they can avoid the donut hole costs as well. And those that can't afford supplemental insurance, they're spending a lot of their income just on these out-of-patient costs for medicines. 10% of Medicare patients spend almost two-thirds of their income just on paying the copays for their medications. High deductible plans are another source of where patients have to pay a lot of money. So we had a study that looked at women with breast cancer, and they looked at women with high to low deductible plans. And they found those with high deductibles are really delaying their care. They're delaying their mammograms, biopsies, diagnosis, and ultimately their chemotherapy. And we have studies that show these delays lead to worse outcomes and more anxiety, so these patients don't do as well. So it's all tied into these financial obligations. So I use this term financial toxicity, and basically I would define it as the financial burden that these patients have and how it affects their lives and how it cause the behaviors and the stress it causes. And I think of it the same way I would think of chemotherapy causing hair loss or nausea. That was the true toxicity of the therapy. And we don't really talk about this too much in the clinic, and I think there needs to be more discussions about it so the patient is aware of what's coming. So a lot of times we'll get bills that will be completely caught off guard. And I'm going to borrow a quote here that I like: the individuals most harmed and least engaged in cost discussions are the patients, because they are exhausting their energy, resources, and time fighting for their lives. So what can a physician do here? Is there anything we could do to help? So I look at it two ways, and a lot of doctors, and myself included for a long time, avoid the issue of cost altogether, because I didn't want to give one person better care than the other based on what they could afford or what their insurance was. We want to be equitable for everyone. But I think we do need to think about how a treatment choice will affect the patient's financial well-being. Look at the overall picture. And so what often happens is patients only bring up, you know, money and the cost of their care after, if they've been distressed, after they've gotten a bill they weren't expecting, something that they can't deal with. And patients don't like to bring it up. They don't want that to influence my decision of what I do for them. They don't obviously want me to do what I think is best, or they're embarrassed to talk about it. We don't want care being rationed differently based on socioeconomic status, though. So I think we need to be more proactive where the physician actually brings it up when they're talking about their treatment recommendations. And we'll talk about how physicians feel about this, because there's studies on that. But if you don't feel like you have time to do it or educated enough, there's resources that we have: patient navigators, financial counselors, the pharmacy team helps out a lot with this. But there's ways to get around this. Often we can give support through various means to help these patients, patient assistance programs and such like that. So I think, you know, a standard part of the interview should also include the question, do you have concerns about the cost of your treatment? Now, in oncology, it's not uncommon. Basically, every time the treatment paradigm changes, there's some landmark trial that's published in the New England Journal or something like that, where one thing shows improvement over the existing standard of care, and so then oncologists have that, and they switch to that better thing, right? And that's just based on patients doing better, living longer, but cost isn't factored in at all. But often you see these studies, and it really might only improve their life or increase their life 2 weeks or something like that at a cost of hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. I think the patient should have some say in the, is it really worth it for me to get all these extra costs, and if it's only going to increase my life in 2 weeks, you know, that's a decision they should be involved in. It's hard for physicians to have these conversations if they don't know what they're prescribing costs. So if something where we have more transparency and actually look at that data to see, so when we have these discussions, we actually know what we're talking about. And the truth is, there's patients that might want an extra drug if it's only going to give them a little bit more life. They'd rather put that money towards other things, like stopping work early, spending time with their family, taking a vacation, that sort of thing. Now, when physicians were surveyed about talking to their patients about cost, they reported that they didn't really understand it. They don't consider cost. They didn't feel like they had enough knowledge or education to have these discussions. And or just didn't feel like it was their duty to explain cost. And so I think, again, we need more transparency. We actually need to know what all these things cost. And then I'd like to see, in the training programs, residencies, fellowships, this actually becomes part of your training, where you learn how to assess these costs and values of treatment so you can talk to your patients about that. But my biggest fear in all of this is really how it can affect the patient-physician relationship. So if I'm trying to actually help the patients, save them from a big financial burden by not adding a treatment that I don't think they're really going to make much of a difference, but they think I'm holding it back because I'm afraid, you know, about getting paid, then our relationship's going to suffer a lot. So when you have these conversations, so that you realize, they realize you're, what you're doing is for their best interest, not yours. So switch gears a little bit, talk about why the prices are so high at these trends that we use. There's really little correlation with how much they cost and how good they are. And drug companies quote about $1 billion per drug to bring it to market for R&D, for other drugs they've tried and haven't worked out, and then regulations and the trials they have to run to get the FDA to approve it. But like I said, there's drugs that cost over $100,000 a year that increase survival by 10 days in most ways. And it's not just the cost. These extra drugs have side effects as well. So this graph shows how, you know, the median monthly household income stayed flat, just for inflation, but the price of new drugs has just gone on this upward trajectory, especially in the immune therapy era, which you guys probably see commercials for or heard about. Now we're starting to combine these drugs together, so two expensive drugs together, so this is going to keep taking off. And then even old drugs, it's not like when they come out, a certain price it stays there, it keeps going up. These are just drugs over the years, how their prices increase with one exception down here, which we'll talk about. But, you know, it doesn't follow the rule of normal economics with where there's more competition for prices go down. It seems like with more competition, prices actually go up because each drug keeps trying to increase the price for the next one to show that they're better. This story is interesting, though. Why did this drug in particular go down? So this was a drug basically that works through the vascular system to help our chemotherapy work better. And there's already one out there that does the same thing. And so Sloan Kettering in New York, which is a very prominent cancer institution, one of the doctors from there wrote an editorial in the New York Times saying, we're absolutely not going to carry this drug. It costs twice as much and it doesn't do anything better. We're dropping this drug. And then about a few weeks later, the drug company actually halved the price of the drug. So, you know, the physician voice does matter about this stuff. We can actually influence how much these drugs cost. So I use the analogy of shopping for a car. You know, when you go in for a car, I don't ask, you know, how much the manufacturing costs or the labor, the parts to put this thing together. I look at the prices of a few options, the different features, and pick the best one for me. And so that's led to better and better options in the car market. But that doesn't happen with these medications. They don't really consider what's better, what's easier to tolerate for the patient. Their strategy is really just, what's the last drug that came out? Okay, how much did that cost? Let's add a little more to it, and that's how they're priced. So in that world, they're really still incentivized to bring a drug that isn't really much better than what we already have to market. They still make money off of it, rather than trying to develop a whole different novel class of drug that might have more benefit. These oral drugs are particularly a problem for patients. And there's been more and more oral anti-cancer drugs coming out. So the IV drugs are pretty well covered under Medicare Part D. Or sorry, Medicare Part B. But the oral drugs are under Part D, and we've talked about that cost sharing and the donut hole there. So often I see the patients that have the most trouble are the ones that are on these oral medications. And so we know from studies that we've done that these increased costs, people are not filling their oral prescriptions or they're skipping doses to make their supplies last longer. And basically not adhering and discontinuing these medications that really keep the cancer away, keep it under control, and really improve survival. So, you know, we see these patients in the clinic and you're like, oh, cancer's getting worse. I need to switch you to something. I need to order a whole bunch of tests, more expensive therapy. You know, sometimes they go to bone marrow transplants, which are incredibly expensive. But the fact is, this is only happening because they can't afford taking the prescriptions they are. If we made it so they could afford their medications, we could actually save a whole bunch of costs that we incur when we think the treatment's failed, when it really hasn't failed, it's just the patient hasn't committed to take it. So CML was disease where they came up with a really good oral drug, and that really changed how we treat this drug. It's a great breakthrough. We know these patients with higher copays are more likely to either not take it or stop, or take it sparingly. If we could pay for the oral drug like we do for the IV drug somehow to change the policies, then we'd see maybe some differences. Often when you have two equivalent drugs, one's IV and one's oral, you think the IV one would be a lot more expensive, right? They have to come in, they have to get an infusion, they need a nurse, they need IV equipment. But we often choose it as doctors because we know the patient, it'll be better covered under their insurance. Obviously, taking a pill would be a lot easier, but usually they pay more for the pill therapy than the IV therapy. That's interesting. We talked about imatinib. This is a drug you take every day for people with chronic myeloid leukemia. Using just as few as three doses can lead to resistance to the disease and the drug not working anymore. It can ultimately lead to things like a bone marrow transplant. Obviously, that transplant would cost more than it would if we could just supply a patient with these pills for an affordable cost. And what's interesting is people live longer with this disease in Europe than they do in the U.S. And one hypothesis for this is that the European healthcare system, a lot of people don't have to pay all for their medications, so they're more likely to get them and take them than they are in the U.S. Let's talk about the FDA a little bit. So the FDA, when it looks at a new drug application, it doesn't take into account costs at all. And there's some good things about this. We want to have the best drugs on our market for our patients. Regardless of what they cost, if they're going to make a difference for our patients, they should be approved. So that way the government can't limit our options and ration healthcare. The UK is different, though. They do use this data when they decide whether or not to apply a drug. I don't know if you guys have heard of CAR T cells. It's like a new therapy for blood cancers, and incredibly expensive, but it does help patients that would have had no option before. And I just saw in the paper today that it's been approved for kids in the UK, but they decided not to approve it for adults. And so when they do these, you know, cost-effective analyses, kids have more years to live, so it shows a greater benefit for them. But just to kind of show you how the UK does things. So that's not something I'd want to see here, obviously. I'm sure oncologists in the UK are frustrated they don't have access to all the medicines I do, because they actually do deny approval for drugs based on cost, which we don't do here. And then Medicare is not allowed to negotiate drug prices with the pharmaceutical manufacturer as well. And so basically they can charge whatever they want. And then we know a lot of the private insurance is based there, figured on Medicare. So what Medicare does is really important. And so what's led to this is just drug companies coming out with higher and higher prices. Because Medicare doesn't have a voice, they can't say, this is too much, we won't pay this much. So Medicare can negotiate drug prices that could help bring down costs. A good example of this is the VA. The VA is allowed to negotiate drug prices with the drug companies. And, you know, I worked there, I had access to every cancer medication as I do here. But basically the VA pays half of what Medicare pays when they acquire these drugs because they are allowed to negotiate. They think that $50 to $100 billion would be saved a year if Medicare was allowed to negotiate. So there's a lot of people that advocate that they should be able to do this. And this will trickle down to private insurers because they base their numbers on what Medicare pays. And then 340B pricing is interesting. I think we have this here. And basically, there's a lot of good behind 340B pricing. It allows, you know, better margins so that we have money to care for people that, you know, otherwise wouldn't be able to get care. They're uninsured, don't have means. So that's kind of the rationale behind 340B pricing. The savings isn't always passed down to the insured. And so what happens is, essentially, the drug companies, they take this 340B price into account. So like, oh, we need to make up for this. So then they set their prices even higher because they don't want to lose money because of 340B pricing. So contract out has exclusivity, so there's still a bit of a monopoly, so the prices are still high. And getting the generic approved is really hard. It takes a lot of money. It takes a long time. So a lot of people are discouraged to want to do that. And so generics don't get made, and the prices stay up. If we could make that process easier, less costly, we could get more generics and help the problem. And then there's the concept of authorized generics, where the company that made the original drug that makes its own generic discourage other generics from coming to the market. That allows them to keep the original prices high. There's also another thing that they can do again, the company with the original drug. They actually pay generic companies not to make generics so they can keep their drug prices high. And they pay these companies more than they would make by making generics, so those companies agree with this because they're making more money and they don't have to do anything. So it's a win-win for them, but you know, ultimately the patient loses it out because the prices are still kept up high. And so there's, you know, lawmakers, people in Washington that feel like this should be outlawed. I think it costs about $3.5 billion to taxpayers and patients and insurers overall. I think this strategy should be legal. Evergreen is another thing drug companies do. They basically slightly reformulate their medications so that generics can't be made because it's, so if you've got an original drug, somebody comes out with a generic, and then you reformulate the original, you can't use the generic to substitute for it. And so that's one way they can get around prices going down with generics. A common example of this is when they make like a drug that's given twice a day, they make it once a day, extended release formulation, or something like that, or just changing something from a tablet to a capsule or vice versa. So there's obviously a lot of tricks around getting around the strategies that bring prices down. Canada's an interesting one. Drug prices are a lot lower there, and there's a lot of people in Washington, like the late Senator John McCain, that advocate that we should be able to buy drugs from Canada to bring our prices down. But there would be obviously a lot of regulatory issues with this. I don't see this happening, but this is one arena where people are proposing. Pharma has a lot of lobbying power in Washington, so that is going to make this hard as well. There was one study that looked at basically treatment of colorectal cancer patients in Washington State in British Columbia, and the outcomes of the patients were equal. They did just as well in one place versus the other, but it cost the people in Canada half as much because their drugs cost less. So really what we're trying to do is find value. We're trying to find the drugs that work the best. You know, I think it's reasonable for those to cost more drugs that don't work as well. You know, shouldn't cost as much. What is value in cancer care is drugs that keep people alive longer and have less side effects than what we currently have, improve their quality of life, or if they can reduce costs while maintaining the same benefit. And so a couple strategies to try to get there, basically, instead of just letting drug companies set their own price, somehow get to where you use research looking at comparative effectiveness. So like, how much sugar is drug A versus drug B? If it's just a little bit or not at all, it shouldn't really cost much more than drug C. And then the FDA could approve the drug at that particular price. The concern here would be that beneficial drugs might be left off the market and we wouldn't be able to have access to them if drug companies felt like, oh, this isn't going to be profitable, I'm not going to bring this drug to market. But the hope is that their drug companies would go and try to create drugs that have a big, substantial benefit over what we already have, rather than just a little bit marginal benefit. So doing research like this, basically comparing two drugs and seeing how much better one is than the other, and comparing their costs to see if that if the cost justifies how much better it is. There's some issues with that. It's a slippery slope to healthcare rationing. The fears that government would reduce access to drugs. There'd be less incentive to do cancer research, reduce the number of breakthrough therapies. We couldn't individualize care and make case-by-case decisions. A bias to treating younger patients if they nip the CAR T cells because they have more years of life to gain. The ones that are the sickest, they have the worst cancers. Since they don't have as long to live, they would have less access because they have a poor cost-effective ratio. Drug companies would never support this kind of research because it would only limit how much of the drug use is. Would have to be funded. But maybe the FDA can still do what it does where it doesn't consider cost to approve the drug, but once it's approved, require that these numbers come out so you know physicians can better assess the cost-effective ratio of new drugs when they make the decision. Some people propose outcomes-based pricing. Basically, these are risk-sharing agreements. So drug manufacturers aren't paid if what they claim their drug can do doesn't actually happen. And so this might help drug manufacturers identify the people most likely to benefit from the drug rather than all comers. And then value-based insurance design. So right now, the system rewards using high-priced drugs, even if benefits are minimal. But if we had a system where high-value drugs had better coverage, we'd be more likely to use those drugs. And basically, our drug tier price would be based on value rather than price. And then hospitals, healthcare entities would get rewarded for using high-value drugs rather than high-cost drugs. And the patient, physician, and insurer could all benefit from that. And so, again, common theme, trying to get drug companies to stop making marginally effective drugs and find ones that are a lot higher value and really make a difference by reimbursing those better. And I'm going to show you a few examples of different ways we can drive down prices. So biomarkers basically is trying to figure out, you got this new drug, works great on 20% of people, but we don't know who the 20% of people are, so we give it to everyone. So 100% of people are paying the cost, 100% of people are experiencing the toxicity, but only 20% of people benefiting. If we could figure out who those 20% are somehow, and only give it to them, we could spare those that wouldn't work for the cost of toxicities. And so personalized medicine is a concept trying to get there, trying to figure out who this particular drug could work for, and sometimes we use stuff from their genetics and their cancer to figure it out. And again, with these immune drugs, I think this is incredibly important because that's kind of where I get those 20% numbers from about lung cancer. It works for about 20% of people, but everyone's getting it. And these drugs cost hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. One interesting case is this drug abiraterone. It's a prostate cancer drug. And so the standard dose is 1,000 milligrams on an empty stomach. They've done nice studies showing that if you just take a quarter of that with a low-fat breakfast, because that helps it absorb, you get just the same concentrations in your bloodstream as 1,000 at, you know, a quarter of the dose of presumably a quarter of the cost. And so that's one way of reducing cost by 75%. So people are looking at ways to try to figure out how we can get around these costs. Another one was out in the clinic here in Rexburg. There's this drug, a new drug for breast cancer, and often we have to reduce the dose because the blood counts go low with it. And so what they've done is they've made three pills that all cost the same at different doses. Whereas the rival drug, you basically go from 3 to 2 to 1 pill if you reduce the dose, which often happens. So with this drug, you actually have cost savings to the patient because they're taking less overall pills, and so that it costs less. This is basically an example of another concept like this, where originally, if you had to reduce the dose for side effects, you actually saved money because it's less amount of pills. So the drug company in retaliation made 4 different strengths that all cost the same. So essentially, making it where you could save money by reducing the dose. With an immunotherapy example, when this drug, pembrolizumab came out, it was a mg/kg dosing, and then they change it to a flat dose. Now, most people let weigh less than 100 gigs, so the 200 milligram dose is more than they probably need. But everyone's getting this flat dose. We thought $800 million could be saved if we went back to the old dosing. So, to summarize my thoughts here, financial toxicity has a lot of impacts on the patient. The oncologist needs to take a more proactive role in this and have these conversations about the cost of care. Drug pricing should be more value-based.